Hi, this is Dr. Naftali Serrano for the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast. You're joining us today from Madison, Wisconsin, and you're being invited for a few minutes to our annual seminar series on being a BHC. So today we're talking about communication with primary care providers and, for trainees, communication with their supervisors that mirrors the work that they do in communicating with primary care providers. So you're going to get the expertise of our excellent staff here who are going to give us some tips on communicating with primary care providers and for trainees communicating with their supervisors.
Dr. Chantel Thomas. Chantel, what tips can you give us for communicating with primary care providers?
So one of the things I think is most essential when you're communicating with a primary care provider is to consider who you're communicating with. Even within the range of the providers that you may work with, you may experience that some of them have different preferences in terms of the information that they want you to emphasize. Some providers might be more interested in background information. Some providers are very concise in their focus and want to know just what do they need to do today. You'll learn more about provider preferences just by paying attention to the way they engage with you when you're giving them feedback. If they start looking away from you, if they start looking to their left or their right, chances are they're ready to be done with the conversation. So pay attention to those things. I think the most essential thing for me is brevity and clarity in terms of your conceptualization. If you tend to waffle around in your feedback, chances of them consulting with you again in the future are going to be lower, not to mention the fact that when they're running behind, they particularly are not going to involve you in a consult.
Excellent. Good stuff. Who's next?
I can go next
This is Dr. Megan Fondell.
Hi. So I would agree with what Chantel was talking about, and I would also say that getting to the bottom line quickly is always appreciated by the providers. If they have questions and they want to get more information, they can ask, and then you can respond and give them more information. So yeah, paying attention to the cues that they're giving you is really important, but having practiced in your head ahead of time what you want to say in terms of the bottom line, which should include a very brief description of your overall impression and what they need to do about it. So what does this matter for them? Being responsive to their day, if they're having a crazy day and your feedback is really just informational and there's actually nothing they need to do, maybe you can wait until later and you don't need to interrupt their whole flow. So you can be sensitive to those kinds of cues as well.
Awesome.
I can go next.
Dr. Elizabeth Zeidler Schreier, mother of Colin.
All right. I can definitely echo both what Chantel and Megan had said. I think it is important to catch a provider when they're going to be most receptive to the feedback and the impressions that you have. And so I will sometimes just check in, do you have a minute now? I say minute because you need to make sure that you stick and have it be succinct, brief, and to the point. As far as with trainees, when I'm working with trainees, I use more of the map. So I like you to tell me what is their motivation. Then your brief assessment, and then the plan. I know that Naftali does plan first. I think that both can be very effective. I like to know what you think, and therefore, what are we going to do about it? I also really encourage when you get the handoff to check in with the provider around when they want to see the patient back, because you're able then to kind of pair your visit associated with that, or if they don't need to see them for a month, but there's something more pressing that we'd like to see them back in 2 weeks. You're able to stagger the visits in a more appropriate fashion. But it's nice to know that ahead of time. And as a supervisor, when I ask you, when do they need to see the provider again? It's like, I don't know. And the provider has already gone on to the next patient, and the patient doesn't know when they need to be seen back. It creates some confusion. And so I think for efficiency of clinic flow, it's helpful to ask it at the outset so we can all be on the same page with planning.
Awesome. Great tips. All right. This is Marta Saucedo.
Again, I'm just going to add, because I agree with whatever has said, it depends. Each clinic have their own system, but in our clinics, it's also important to know if the patient needs to go to labs. Sometimes the physician is waiting for us to actually do that step. So it's important to ask if they have other things to do in the clinic before they go. And we can help the patient do that after they have seen us. For students, I will say it's very common at early stages to get lost in a subjective, and they will come and start telling you all that story. So always to start with the plan and the assessment, or not get confused that the assessment is actually all the subjective. So a clue to have that differentiate that is whatever was said in the patient on session, that's very much the subjective. But your impressions of what's going on, that's going to be more the assessment. So that can be a clue of if it's information that patient told me in session, most likely you're telling subjective information there. So that's a good clue to differentiate when they're reporting to a supervisor or even the PCP. If it's my impression of what's going on, that's actually the assessment, and then go back to that one as well.
Cool. Thank you very much. Ashley Grosshan.
Oh, no. No? I'm never going to get this right.
Grosshan.
I think there's been a lot of great points already made, so I'll just kind of piggyback off of that. But trying to just answer what the provider is wanting. So when you get a referral question, being tuned into what the provider is asking you to touch on with the patient and really what they're wanting to know, and then bringing that back to them. And if it, if that ended up not being the focus of the consult, being clear about why that happened without storytelling, and just, knowing that the provider can always ask more questions. So giving them the basics, and if they want to know more, then they always can do that.
Awesome. Thank you very much. All right, now we're going to put some trainees on the spot as well. Just to give you some, we have one newer staff person that I forgot about.
Well, I think most things have been said. What Ashley said was actually one of the things I was thinking about, but also you can get an idea of how much providers want to know by how much they tell you. Like the amount of time they devote to telling you about the patient, asking the questions, is about how much information they want back.
Excellent, thank you. So we're gonna put trainees on the spot here real quick, and this is just to give your own subjective experience of what it feels like to be giving feedback to primary care providers. So, and I want you to reflect also on what it felt like initially and maybe what it might feel like right now. Don't all speak at once.
Okay, I can go first. Sarah Conklin. This is my first time in primary care, so doing this as working with primary care providers was really intimidating to begin with. You have this view of doctors as being highly educated, kind of having the answers. So going to them with kind of my opinion and my plan and my assessment was intimidating to begin with. But as I've created relationships with them and knowing how they like things presented, becoming far more comfortable.
Cool. Very good. So you'd say you feel a lot more comfortable now than the beginning?
I mean, the primary care providers that I work with more often, yes. The ones that I'm still kind of creating relationships, it's a little more tentative, but.
Okay. Yeah.
Go in order.
All right.
I'm Jessica Brooks, an intern here. To be honest, I think I was a little surprised about the dynamics between myself and the providers. I've worked in different settings, but I worked at a specialty clinic at the VA hospital before in the geriatric unit. And just the way they interact and they do look at us like we're colleagues, I really appreciated that. And so I think it then changed the way I react to them and the way that I compose myself and speak to them. So. I really enjoy them interacting.
Cool. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it definitely makes a big difference, right? How they treat you. And not every clinic is going to have that collegial mm-hmm. atmosphere that our clinic definitely has, kind of to a degree that's outstanding. So mm-hmm. it does make it easier. Yeah.
Pretty pronounced mutual respect for each other's discipline.
Yeah.
Able to build on each other's strengths.
Yeah, absolutely. Any other comments from trainees? Oh, all right, two more here.
I think intimidation, like Sarah said, is the correct word. I still don't feel 100% comfortable, but I think practicing assertiveness is going to be huge for me, so I'm excited about that. I think, and before y'all joined us for this podcast, we were talking about nonverbals, and I've seen differences. So if a provider comes and sits down and they're like joining with you, I think they might want a little more, and I've seen that with different providers. And then other providers, I'll be giving feedback, and they're still typing on their computer, so it's very brief. They have patients to see, and they're busy. So I think just the nonverbals that they're displaying kind of cue me into, okay, they either want a 30-second or they want like a 2-minute consult. So I think nonverbals have been helpful.
Gustavo Medrano. I think the biggest change for me has been just in my training, having hour-long sessions to be able to focus on more of the subjective, more of the storytelling, and really in the shifting to primary care, really the focus in on the, you know, trying to create a functional analysis, understand what are the problems, and then assess along with assessing motivation, which is much more variant in specialty settings. What are the maybe one or two things that we can really focus on? With the brief time that we have, and communicating that with the primary care provider effectively, so that we can hopefully make some movement in those couple areas, and taking a much more sequential focus rather than this very vast sort of disorienting focus. That's oftentimes in specialty care, you have more time to do that, but here there's advantages to primary care that they can bring them back more frequently, and so thinking about it more sequentially that way.
Yeah, it's definitely different than a multidisciplinary conference where people sit down around a table, right? All right, anybody else? Well, thank you very much, everybody. I know that the podcast audience is always appreciative to see the real faces and stories behind the work that's being done across the country in this. So thanks for listening again. This is Dr. Serrano for the Behavioral Health Consultation Podcast. Hopefully more of these faces in the future.